good to us, and you've given us your word, that your word might feed us and build us and encourage us. And Lord, I pray that this morning that you'll do just that. Lord, let your word accomplish in us all that you desire, and we commit it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we said earlier, welcome, and especially if you're a new student coming into town, we want to welcome you and welcome back any of the other students that will be here some this week, but probably most next week of the students that are part of our church now. Where is Mary? Ah, sitting right there. Phil and Mary right there. Okay, those hands that are just waving up there, have you just stand up for a minute, both of you guys. Okay, if you're a uni student and you're new to town, have a talk with these guys afterwards and I'll fill you in on the small group, the Connect group, that runs at their home, which is straight opposite the colleges up at the uni. Okay, now we want you to stay around and have a cuppa and have a yarn with Nick and Ruth. And I trust that we'll all be able to do that and that you'll be able to come tonight as well. And young people, particularly if you're coming tonight, we'd really love you to give us some help in the annual rolling up of calendars for Red Frogs. Okay, we've got a whole lot of calendars that need to be rolled up. So if you can help us tonight, that would be absolutely wonderful. And we still need some volunteers to help for Tuesday at O-Week and Lifesaver Day. So if you can help, please let me know. Okay, our theme for 2013 is the Empowered Church. And we've been looking particularly over the last few weeks, we've been talking about community. One of the great empowering agents of the church. We were designed, we were created not to be alone. We were designed and created to live in relationship with others. In other words, to have community. So I want to continue this morning looking at that. But particularly what I'm going to do this morning is to grab the story out of the newsletter that's been last week and this week's newsletter and just expand on that, just talk a little about it. It's actually a true story. Dr. Rene Spitz wrote extensively about the things that he discovered as a result of the orphanage that he was running and the incredible death rate of babies. His study was published under the title, I've got it written down here, An Inquiry into the Genesis of Psychiatric Conditions in Early Childhood. So there's quite a title. That was published way back in 1945. 34 out of 91 babies died. That's about 37%, and that would be incredibly worrying. But the reason that Spitz actually found, the reason that they died was not because of poor medical care, but because they weren't shown love. Isn't that amazing? They died from lack of touch and lack of love. The loving touch of a parent or a sibling or a grandparent or whatever was missing from their lives. And I just think this is incredibly tragic. And yet it's also an amazing and very graphic illustration of the reality, the simple reality that we've been talking about. We were designed to have relationship. We were designed to be in community. We were designed to have true human companionship. But more than that, we need that relationship and that companionship, that community, to be mutually interactive. Now, quite the opposite to Dr. Spitz, I was listening to something that I found quite fascinating, where I think she was a professor of psychology at a university in Europe, and she's been undertaking some research with babies and playing with puppets in front of babies. And she has found that a little baby, unable to talk and all the rest of it, actually will respond to right and wrong. And she was able to set up some experiments where the babies would respond to things that were good and reject things that were bad. Now, what I'm talking about are things that are good. There was one where the puppet would have a fight with another puppet over obtaining something, and the one who was trying to fight in would back off and allow the other one just to take it. And the babies responded positively to this one. Then there was an experiment where exactly the opposite happened, where this one was able to take it, but this one grabbed it off them, and they responded to this one. Really interesting that they were able to distinguish between good and bad at such a young age. I wonder why it is. I think it's because innately, God has built us for good relationship. Now, the babies weren't able to express whether they were going to be good or not, but they were able to recognise the difference between good and bad. See, we need interaction that's positive. We need community. We need family. And I'm suggesting that our spiritual life is actually designed exactly the same way as our natural life. That is, Christian fellowship, or the community of Christians, is the kind of touch and interaction that's necessary to help keep Christians healthy and growing in the things of God. Let's have a look in Hebrews chapter 10. I'm just going to read verse 24 and 25. Let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I think too many Christians are tempted from time to time just to drop out for whatever reason it might be. And they say, well, nobody's going to miss me. And then they say things like, besides that, you're going to be a Christian without going to church. Well, yes, you can be a train that never leaves the station as well. But that's not what it was made to do. That's not the purpose for which it was created. And likewise, yes, you can be a Christian and never go to church. But that is not the reason that God wants you to be part of his family. He doesn't create you to be in isolation. And what we see consistently are the same results in the lives of people who travel this path. And that is, their faith often diminishes and their love for God diminishes, and somehow their love even for the people of God just seems to fade away and they drift off. It's not a good thing. So the question is, why? Why is Christian fellowship so important? Why is it community? Why is it important to have a Christian community? Why is Christian fellowship such a key thing in our life? I think essentially there are a bunch of reasons. There's at least four that we talked about in the newsletter, and I just want to build on them a little this morning. The first of these elements is that it provides us an environment in which our faith can be nurtured. So God wants Christian fellowship to be a place where our faith is nurtured and built. I personally would find it very, very difficult to be in a Christian community where I was constantly being taught how evil I was. Now, I'm not being critical of anybody else. I'm just saying I would find it difficult to be in an environment where things are so negative. I was watching a documentary just last night, I think it was, and the guy, I understand exactly where he was coming from. The preacher was saying, have you ever stolen? Have you ever lied? Have you ever done any of these things? And of course, people would say, yes, I've lied. Yes, I've stolen. Yes, I've done it. And so he would point out that you're a thieving, lying, and on through the list he'd go. And that's fine. But what my Bible tells me is this. Paul actually wrote to, of all places, the Corinthian church, which was not on the list of good example churches to write to. And Paul wrote to them and said, understand this, that there's no liars, no thieves, no adulterers, no fornicators, all of these things that he listed. None of them are going to get into the kingdom. And then he said something interesting. And he said this, such were some of you. Such were some of you. Some of you were exactly that. Thieves, liars, whatever. He says, that's what you were. But. And then I always say but when I write it down. I got a cross and what you used to be before it. Okay? And Paul comes and he says, you're like that, but you met Jesus. And something happened. You were redeemed. You were justified. You were made holy. And I want us to understand that God intends for us to walk in the relationship with him that he has designed and to know that the price has been paid for your sin. Jimmy, when Jesus died, now this is not a trick question, okay? When Jesus died, it isn't. When Jesus died, how long ago was that? Roughly. 2,000 years, roughly? Yep. Okay. At that point, how many sins had you committed? He wasn't even born. I thought he was holding his age real well there for a minute. That's right. You weren't even born. That means that what Jesus actually did was to die and pay the price for future sin. Is that right? Is that right? Anybody grab that?
Yeah.
Pretty simple. Mark, when you received Jesus, your sins from the past were forgiven. Is that good? Okay, what about the ones tomorrow? They're forgiven as well, even though they're future. That's because everything was future when Jesus died. Okay? We've got to understand that what Jesus has done when he brought us into his family is to give us something that is good. Yeah. And we have been made whole. Our sins have been forgiven. That's why I say I am not a sinner saved by grace. I used to be, but when I got saved by grace, I became a saint who still sins and who still has forgiveness through the cross. So I want to say that we need an environment which nurtures positive faith and that gives us a positive outlook and understanding of who and what we are. I don't think any of us would argue that we live in a post-Christian culture in Australia and right across the Western world in particular. So if we are told to retain and promote Christian values in the midst of a culture that increasingly finds the message irrelevant to them, we must be very, very intentional about what we say and what we do if we are going to be deliberately a counter-culture, a distinctly Christian community. It doesn't happen by accident. We've got to work at it. But together we can stand and we can reinforce the values that we know are life-giving and liberating values. Values that keep our head lifted up rather than having our head down and feeling miserable and guilty all the time. So together we can stand against the tide of immorality and godlessness. And it is rife in our society. We know that. We know the society that we live in. But we can encourage one another and we can build one another and we can protect one another. We can stand together against that tide. We share our struggles. We share with one another and each helps the other to stand. We organise ourselves for strength. We teach faith. We teach the faith. In other words, the Christian principles in life to children. We share it because we know it is life changing. It is life changing. Nothing can bring a change into a life as much as the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, let's understand. Every culture Every society communicates its values. I don't care what society it is, every society, every culture communicates its values. The secular media is absolutely unrelenting in the way that it communicates its values. You know, what I find, and maybe I'm unique in this, but I don't think so. What I find is I listen to journalists interviewing politicians, and I can tell you after about 2 minutes which side of politics the journalist's on. They don't ever say, but somehow they communicate their values. They can't help it. It's a natural thing. We naturally communicate our values. And images flash across our screens that challenge our faith. Have you noticed, or is it just me, but have you noticed that somehow the ads are becoming more suggestive and more smutty than they have been in the past? How suggestive so many of them have become? We're bombarded by extramarital relationships to such an extent that we almost see it as normal. In fact, a lot of people in society do. The same thing applies to other issues, homosexuality, abortion, and the list can go on. We're told that these things are normal. It's okay, it's acceptable, because there's no absolute value. And that's the value that's communicated by our society. So if I listen to them, what is important? If I got my values from my TV set, what would be important in life? Well, perfume, cars, a good interest rate, having a tan body, despite the fact that you're going to get skin cancer, but who worries? Lying on a beach resort, being happy and comfortable all day. And of course, you've got to wear the right brand of shoes and drink the right brand of beer. These values are constantly imposed on us. And I say imposed on us because if they came knocking on the door and said, we want to tell you about these products, we wouldn't bring them into our home. But we turn our television on and invite them in. So these values are transmitted by ads on TV, by films. Do you know how much money companies pay to a movie company to have a can of Coke sitting on the table? So the camera kind of goes, woo. Anytime you watch a movie and you see a product there that you can identify, let me guarantee that company paid a fortune to have that picture there. It's not there by accident. We get these by ads, by films, by magazines and so forth. And then there's the TV soaps. I don't know why they call them soaps, because they're so dirty, but how do we protect ourselves? How do we sort out our values when we're bombarded by this sort of stuff?
Turn it off,
absolutely. Do you know, the same principle works with things like gossip and murmuring. I reckon murmur is one of the best words in the English language, because, you know, it describes itself. Murmur, murmur, murmur. Murmur, murmur. Gossip, murmur, murmur. Do you know, a gossip is one who transmits. Do you know what? A transmitter is useless unless you've got a receiver turned on. So you want to kill some gossip? Turn it off. People can say what they like, turn off the receiver. All right? And you're exactly right. Do that with the ads too, Clive. Absolutely the way to go. But we know how peer groups dominate the teen years. What mum and dad says are really not all that important. What is important is what everybody else is doing. But everyone does it. Every parent has heard that. Everyone does it. And they've heard it at least twice. Once when they said it when they were young, and when they hear it from their own kids. Okay. That's what really matters. Yeah, the teen subculture is powerful. It has its own belief system, its own jargon, and its own way of commanding conformity among the peers. Parents too become deeply influenced by culture. We are told to earn as much as we can, regardless of what it takes. Conform with the drinking habits of your workmates, and at least try, at least give illicit drugs a go before you knock them. We sometimes just don't recognise the danger that we're in. The third sheep started to count, or at least the fourth one. 3.5 sheep for that. So number four was getting worried. It's important to be part of a clear-cut Christian community. We can find refuge there, and that's what we are meant to do. We can find encouragement. We can find strength. We and our children have an opportunity to resist the pressures of the secular world that's around us. It's part of what we might say the Christian counterculture that keeps us with a cutting edge on our faith. But building this culture, building this Christian community, building the church requires a commitment to the cause of Christ. Maintaining strong Christian community is up to you and me. We're all in this one together. We can sit back and ignore it, or we can actively make sure it happens. And that's what we are meant to be doing. Christian community reinforces our values and helps us in facing a hostile society. But there are times where we get hurt. Now, if anybody has never, ever been hurt, don't worry about what I'm about to say. But if you have been, at any point in your life, and I think that covers us all pretty well, then we understand that there are times where we get hurt and we need healing. Now, even within the context of a Christian community, things sometimes go wrong. And we find ourselves being hurt, or sometimes even disillusioned. And that's where this next vital ingredient of the Christian culture or Christian community comes in: ministering to one another. One of the sad things down through the years is that the church has tried to build a layer in the church of ministers. Now, the fact is, we are all ministers. We are all servants of God together. The church invented a word called clergy. Now, we have the clergy and the laity. The problem with that division is really simple. The laity, where we get that word, is laothou, the people of God. So the laity are the people of God. And I don't understand who the clergy are if they're not the people of God. Can you see that we create a problem when we start to create our own structures? We are together as one. We are together as one. The most level ground that there has ever been is at the foot of the cross. We all came into this in the same way. God gives us different responsibilities and all of that sort of stuff, but ministering, we all stand as one. Every one of you, if you know Jesus, if you've only been a Christian for a week, you've got as much access to God as I do. Okay? I don't get any special privileges, and neither does anyone else. Wherever a tradesman goes, generally his toolbox is not far away. Depending on the trade, there's probably some screwdrivers and spanners and a few other odds and ends. If it's a hairdresser and she's got those things, be worried. But if he doesn't have the whole toolbox, there's at least some tools you can guarantee in the boot, because the toolbox is in the ute at home, so he'll have something with him. And God gives to people within the church, to various members of the church, specific gifts and talents. We talk about, in Pentecostal churches, we talk about the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 and 14. And we talk about the gifts of the Spirit, and we list 9 of them. Every one of those are gifts of the Spirit. No question of that, and I'm not arguing with that for 1 minute. But I have a very strong suspicion that God is bigger than 9 gifts. I just have this impression that God actually is big. And if we think He's limited to 9. Whoa. It's okay. But my God's bigger. And I think that a lot of even talents that people have are gifts from God. Are gifts from God. And if they're gifts from God, the Holy Spirit brings them. And that makes them gifts of the Spirit. All right? When we read the list in Romans, we call them the motivational gifts. But I want to tell you, they're gifts of the Spirit. How else did they come? You grab that? So let's not limit God. God gives incredible gifts and talents into the body of Christ, abilities and strengths and so forth. Why does he do that? He does it so that we can minister to one another. We can help one another. We can serve one another. We can together keep the body healthy. And these gifts are just like that toolbox, if you like. We are God's toolbox. Okay? He can use you in a way that he can't use anyone else because you have certain unique characteristics that God has placed in you. If I am to believe, and I do, that God designed me before the creation of the earth, that I was in his mind before he even started and that you were in the same place, then I also have to accept, if that is the case, that God planned everything. He planned you to be who and what you are. He planned me to be who and what I am. I can guarantee you this, that the last thing I ever was expected to do was to preach. When I was a kid, nothing could have been further from anyone's imagination. I wasn't a kid that put up soap boxes and played church. I was an introvert. And the first time I ever preached, I was tricked into it. All right? I've seen others tricked into it. I guess my favourite tricking into was when we went up to New Guinea one time. And we arrived in New Guinea and at 3 o'clock, and we went out to the church compound where we were going to be staying. There was a group from our church in Bendigo. And the mission director there said, "We've got an outreach down the street at 4:30, you're going." Okay? So that was all right. We all go down and we stood there. One of the young ladies that came with us would have been about 19 or so. And she was just standing in the background, and that's where she wanted to be. And we stood there and sang a few songs, and a crowd gathered, which they always do in New Guinea, don't they? You know, as soon as you do something, a crowd comes. And we had this crowd there, and the guy who was leading it turned around to this young girl and said, "Now, so-and-so's going to preach to us." She nearly died on the spot. But what could she do? She had to stand up there and say something. Sometimes God just puts us in situations so he can say, "Hey, I can do this through you. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." Okay? Well, we've got to understand that God designed us to be what we are from so long ago. And so the gifts, you think you've worked so hard in learning that piano. Well, great. I think God gave you the skills to do it, the ability to learn. And whatever else it might be, God gives abilities and we must not overlook them as being gifts from God. There are times where we cannot fix ourselves and we need someone else. Does that mean we lack faith? No. It just means that we're in a situation where we can't access the sort of faith that God has built within us because our mind has put obstacles in the way because of circumstances or whatever else it might be. And we find that we need someone whom God has specially equipped. When we've hit bottom, we need a listening ear sometimes, a word of counsel or loving statement, a friend who will affirm God's forgiveness. When our faith is ebbing, we need someone to pray for us sometimes. When we're confused or unsure, we need someone who can see beyond our situation and can guide us through the Word of God, can guide us and bring us out. But what I find is interesting is when you look at the gifts and talents that God has put into the church, with all of them, or all the ones that I can think of anyway, they don't seem to operate very well in isolation. You ever notice that? They don't operate well in isolation. If you just take the nine in 1 Corinthians, it's horribly hard to go and pray for somebody and see healing happen if there's no one there. All right? The gifts don't seem to operate well in isolation. The fellowship of believers is the context in which the gifts and talents flourish and are expressed. Therefore, Paul said, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you're doing. He's saying, what you're doing is a good thing. Remember last week we talked, just for George's benefit, we talked about the lettuces in the garden, okay? And remember, we can never let us on our own. Never. We can't one another. And the Bible is full of lettuces and one another's. And we can't do them on our own. We need someone else to express love to. We need someone else to be able to express our giftings, to teach somebody or to lead somebody, whatever it might be. We need someone else. We can't do most of the stuff in the New Testament on our own. It doesn't work in isolation. The Bible's instruction are aimed at our fundamental needs. And while that sometimes is directed at an individual level, it's expressed mostly at a corporate level, because we were made for relationship. We were designed and created for community. So in the Christian community, we find the gifts that are necessary to bring healing and wholeness and to build us up in our life. Then there's the third one. Setting examples for us to follow. Have you ever stopped to think how you got to be where you are today? How did it come about that you are who and what you are? The chances are very, very high indeed that somewhere along the way you were influenced by others. And sometimes it's a really good exercise to sit down and think about the people who have made a positive impact on your life and have influenced you to such an extent that you tried in some way to copy the person. You've tried to imitate the things that are good. Now, sometimes that's good, but we're not told to copy one another. We're told to imitate one another in terms of our faith and our walk in God. I find it interesting when I look around that sometimes when people try and imitate someone, they actually try and copy exactly the way that they do things. How many song leaders have I seen that have dyed their hair blonde and worn long coats and tried to look like Darlene? Lots of them. I've seen lots of them do that. Sometimes I have a bit of a chuckle and think, yeah, that's right, Jacob, don't ever do that wherever you are. It just wouldn't suit you. But we do. I mean, and I don't think that's necessarily a good thing. Have you ever noticed, the things that I get really about, as I might turn on the radio and it's the country music festival in Tamworth and they're interviewing one of the local artists, you know, and they say, how are you going? And they say, oh yeah, pretty good. Where are you from? Oh, I'm from Dubbo. And they have a good old talk and they're obviously good Aussies. Will you sing for us? Yep. And all of a sudden, they've got an American accent. Have you ever noticed that? I wonder why. I bet you they don't even know they're doing it. It's just that they've been influenced. They probably heard a song, that's how it was sung, and they pronounce and do everything exactly the same way. Now, I don't think that's really a good idea. It's not so much a copying in the sense of doing exactly the same way, and I walk like this or whatever. It's copying, it's learning, it's imitating the good things that God has placed within us. If you want to imitate things, look in people for things like patience and faith and loyalty. You know, look at these things that God has put in and allow them to challenge you to such an extent that they influence your life. And I suggest that you choose very carefully whose influence you are willing to receive. Because it's very easy for people to be influenced. I don't know where that one went to, but it's very easy for us to influence or allow people to influence without us even knowing it. Very easy indeed. We see somebody and we want to imitate. It's good to sit down and really think who has and who is strongly influencing your life now. Because it may be worthwhile you saying, whoops, I think I need to be influenced by a different culture altogether. So when we are around people who clearly portray Christ's character, we can be challenged and even stimulated to grow. When we see the fruit of the Spirit operating and flash before our eyes, we're eager to try it out for ourselves. When we see the gifts of the Spirit being demonstrated, we say, well, I can rise to that. I can be challenged by that. The writer of the Hebrews said this, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Whoa! I tell you what, the greatest faith challenge to me in the whole of my life was not by some great preacher or missionary. It was by a South African couple in our church in Warrigal. The absolute greatest example of faith. They had three girls and they desperately wanted a boy. She fell pregnant. And everything was going fine. They had ultrasounds and knew that they were having a boy. So they named him long before he was ever born. His name was Joshua. And it was never, how's the baby going? She'd say, Joshua's good. Sadly, something went tragically wrong. And Joshua was born, what was it, Chris, 16 and a half weeks early. Which is very early. Now, they took him down to a hospital in Melbourne that specialises in premature babies, and they didn't have a humidity crib small enough for him. They had to make one out of a shoebox. And I kid you not, he would fit in the palm of my hand. I've never seen anything like it in my life. And the doctor said he has no hope. He cannot survive. His lungs are too underdeveloped, he's got this, he's got that. And they went through all of the things that said why this baby could not survive. The only problem with their diagnosis was the faith of the parents. And so it was the faith of the parents versus all of medical science. And I remember he just continued to deteriorate. And I remember getting a phone call one Sunday, just after lunch, in fact, during lunch. And the dad, his name was Merv, said to me, they want to turn the machine off. What should I do? And I said, mate, I'm sorry, but they're not actually asking you. They're telling you that's what they're going to do. Okay? And just remember, your faith has never been in the machine. It's always been in God. And he said, well, if only they could turn it off but leave the oxygen on. I said, well, ask them. They might even do that. Now, I might just say before this happened, the doctors tried to convince the parents that the child couldn't survive, and they just couldn't convince them. And the greatest example of faith for me was out of the mum's mouth when the doctor came round and finally thought he'd got through. And he sat down there and he said, Mrs. Tennyson, Joshua is not going to be able to make it. He's got this, 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 and this. And she said, Doctor, in all of your experience, how many babies born this early and with all of the problems that Joshua has got, how many have you seen survive? And he thought he had a breakthrough, poor doctor. And he said, Mrs. Tennyson, that's what I'm trying to tell you. None. Do you know what she said? She smiled and said, oh good, Joshua will be the first. I tell you what, that sort of faith makes me squirm. Wow, I stand in awe. You know, it was interesting that from the moment they turned the machine off, and they did leave the oxygen on, from the moment they turned the machine off and took medical science out of the way, and it was now just the faith of the parents, he began to improve from that moment on. He's still alive today. He'd be probably about 18, I suppose, now, wouldn't he? And last I heard, the only medical treatment he'd ever had was grommets. So join the majority, he's fine. But that faith was such a challenge to me. And I tell you what, I want to try and imitate that faith. I want to try and copy that faith. Being around that sort of faith just has to inspire you. Either that or you're dead inside. I'm not sure which. But being a part of a body of believers can keep us balanced. In church, I discover a well-balanced menu of role models. And I can say, gee, I'd like to have faith like that person. Or I'd like to know the Bible like that person. Or I wish I was as hospitable as that person. Or I'd like to be as committed as that. We find all of these things to challenge us. And we want to try and imitate them. And doing that changes lives. Now look at this in Thessalonians. You became imitators of us and of the Lord, and so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. Wow. Wouldn't that be a great testimony to have? So fellowship gives us examples that spur our faith. And very quickly, the last is to support us when the going is getting tough. Now, when I asked Yui, the insurance company, for a quote on my home insurance, they asked very strange questions. And the one that stood out to me was, do you know your neighbours by their first name? And what they were trying to do was to find out if we kind of had an unofficial neighbourhood watch going. That's really what they were trying to find out. Do you know each other? Do you look out for each other, is what they were saying. Now, ours is a bit of a neighbourly community, and we have Christmas brekkie and together, and we know each other and all of that sort of stuff. And that's the principle that Neighbourhood Watch actually functions on. We look out for one another. If we see something suspicious, you know, we call the police. We'll act together against the common enemy or threat. And fellowship in a church is at its best when people are watching out for one another, not looking for ways to criticise somebody, but ways to help and encourage one another. We need to be looking out for one another to encourage and build them up. We help each other through unpredictable turns of life. Someone recently encountered a problem that shook them, and I was really encouraged to see they came to church to find someone to support and bless them. And while they probably felt, gee, it was such a blessing to be with people who would care for me, I was blessed to think that they actually did that. You know, it goes both ways, doesn't it? And we want to be an expression of community. That is what it's all about. When someone in the church gets sick, we rally behind them. And by the way, if you do happen to get sick and land up in hospital, make sure you let us know. It's really hard to visit if we don't know you're there. All right? And that's often the case. Paul says, look, if someone's caught in a sin, if you're spiritual, go and restore them gently. Oh, I like that. Restore them gently, because the way we normally try and restore people caught in sin is go, you did this, you miserable sinner. Restore them gently. Lay hands on them, not two at a time, but gently. Okay? We're there to bless and encourage. We are all needy at times. Everyone has been lonely or discouraged or depressed. There's times where you've longed for someone to be with you and to bless you. Jesus said, do to others as you want them to do to you. Now, we always think of that in the negative, you know. In fact, I used to quote that scripture quite incorrectly and say, do unto others before they do it unto you. All right, but I want to suggest that maybe Jesus was speaking in the positive. Yeah? You bless people because that's what you want them to do to you. You want to be blessed. You want to be encouraged. So go do it to others. Okay? The help that we give to members of the body of Christ is just doing it to Jesus. Whatever you do for one of the least of these brothers or sisters, then you do it for me. We're not going to read these scriptures, but we know the scripture in Ecclesiastes, two are better than one. You stand together. There's a strength in as we multiply the number. When we stand together and watch out for each other's good, we know that strength comes. We who are strong ought to bear the failings of the weak and not just please ourselves. When, it's funny, you know, as Christian sheep, we've got this perverse trait. When we suffer burnout or sin or guilt or something, what we do, we avoid other Christians like the plague. I don't know why we do that. Maybe we get embarrassed or something, I don't know, but we try and avoid it. We actually should be gravitating to them. It's as though the wolf is getting there ready to catch the stray sheep. But the Christian community cares for the straying sheep. You know, we should be able to say, gee, missed you on Sunday when we see somebody down the road. Are you okay? You know, how are you traveling and all this sort of stuff. More reason that we have when we're unraveling to come into relationship in the body and get people to pray for us and support us. Christian fellowship is indispensable. The community reinforces our faith, its talents, its gifts, its strength, heal us, and the godly example of members, it builds us up and acts as a role model and supports us in time of need. We were made for community. We were created for community. Like the babies in Dr. Spitz's orphanage. I think it was called the Foundling Home. And these babies who lacked a cuddle, who lacked a loving touch, died. And I think Christians can shrivel up and die without fellowship. We can become weak and miss out on the full purpose, miss out on the destiny that God really wants for us. But it is always amazing when we do what God intended us to do, live the way that He intended us to live, when we reach out and we touch someone and bless them. Community is not just a gift from God for us. It's actually part of His plan and purpose. It's what we were made for. Let's just pray. Father, I just pray again this morning that Your word will just work in our heart and life, and Lord, encourage us, challenge us, do whatever You will. But Lord, I pray that our hearts would want to be knit close in with one another and be supportive of one another, that we can bless others, Lord, just as You bless us. So we commit the word to You now. And Lord, we just believe that Your Spirit will make it life and real to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the prayer team's been at work praying before church. And Mary's just going to give you some of the words that they got.
We had a word about someone, a lady who feels that she's different from other people, and this is blocking her being able to connect and relate to other people. There's a lady with pain in the right side of her head and upper body. Somebody has pain or some sort of problem in their right shoulder. Somebody had the words, let my people go. If that relates to you, come forward and we can pray about that situation. A female, there's lots of ladies today. A female who's really struggling to be here, really struggling to get to church, and she's feeling that if nothing changes, she's going to give up and stop coming. God wants you to know that He's heard your prayer and He wants to answer that. So if that's you, please come forward and let us pray for you. And somebody with deep emotional pain experiencing symptoms in the gut area with that. And of course, if anybody has any other problems, please come out and let us pray for you.
Okay, we're going to sing. Thanks, Mary. We're going to sing, and straight after that, the prayer team will be available.
This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. This is my prayer in the fire, in weakness, in trial or pain. There is a faith proved of more worth than gold, so refine me, Lord, through the flame. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. And I will rejoice, and I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. And I will rejoice, and I will declare, God is my victory and He.
Father, we thank You, we honour You, and as we go out today, Lord, we know that Your presence doesn't stay here, Your presence goes with us. And I pray that each one of us will be conscious of Your presence today and throughout the remainder of this week. Lord, we bless each one to You in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you this morning. Cup of tea out there. Remember, a bit of fellowship with Nick and Ruth. And tonight... And young people, again, let me say tonight, older ones can help as well, just rolling up some calendars. Thanks.
are consumed. We are consumed by. We set. We set our lives up. We are consumed. Let's sing it again. We are your burning ones. dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne. Oh Lord. Oh.
Fun.
What heart could hold the weight of your love and know the heights of your great worth? What eyes could look on your glorious face, shining like the sun? What heart could hold the weight of your love and know the heights of your great worth? What eyes could look on your glorious face, shining like the sun? You are holy, 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 God most high and God most worthy. You are holy, 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 Jesus, you are, Jesus, you are. Your name alone has power to raise us. Your light will shine when all else fades. Our eyes will look on your glorious face, shining like the sun. Who is like you, God? You are holy, 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 God most high and God most worthy.
Shine. Power. Thank you.